Throughout history, there have been heroes born into greatness. And there have been those who have had it thrust upon them. He never asked to be a hero. He simply fought for everything he knew, everything he loved. It wasn't a question of if he would prevail. It was only a question of when. The Warrior, coming soon.
Love the life I live and live the life I love. I'm retired, avid skier.
He's always this guy that he waves to everybody, friendly. I don't know, he's just like, he's a brother.
Hi, Emiliano. In my life, I think the most important thing is my friendships, the love of family.
Well, what he should know, I always thought he was Superman, because he was the oldest. He's the oldest, so it's just Charles and I. We were taught that if something happens, regardless of what happens, you get there and you be strong.
I know that I've got a special gift, you know, the gift of life. And really, you really don't realize how much you take it for granted when you think everything is right.
I didn't know what to say. I didn't know what to think. And when I rushed down there, they told me what had happened, that they had brought him back to life.
I died three times.
Look familiar, Charles?
Oh, yeah. I can recognize a place now. And I don't know, this might sort of sound weird when I say this, but I'm sort of glad it did happen, because a lot of beautiful realities have come, you know, a lot of nice things. I had just went to the bank to make a deposit. It was like about 8 o'clock in the morning. Put the car up in the garage, and when I got out of the car, all of a sudden, it hit me right about here. I believed it was a muscle cramp. When it hit, it sent me to my knees, and there wasn't a soul in the parking lot. I crawled from the garage to the dumpster, and I crawled from the dumpster to the back door, and I crawled the whole floor to get into the apartment. I didn't call the EMTs at that time. I thought it was just a chest pain I was having. And being that I fly every 6 months, I have to have a physical from a flight surgeon. So I was just in good health. So I didn't really realize, you know, what was going on until the sweats came. It's a funny thing, when the heart shuts down, you break out into a sweat you wouldn't believe. Like you jogged 35 or 40 miles.
Scared?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, it makes you think. It really makes you think. And then you go through a lot of mind things.
We went there for, I believe, a heart problem or a breathing problem. Went into his apartment, and he was there all alone. And we went into his bedroom, and we saw this gentleman that was, I could tell that there was a problem.
He yanked me off the bed, put me on the floor. I can remember that much. The call was made at 9:03. They arrived here at 9:08. And they gave me an EKG at 9:12.
We use leads that are put across the chest wall and then some on the extremities. And that 12 lead allows us to look at the heart from 12 different angles. Unlike we used to have, we never used to have that ability.
Then they left here at 9:30, which came to 18 minutes total time that they were here.
And Charles had said, I want to go to St. Joe's Hospital.
I arrived at St. Joseph's in 28 minutes from the time that I called.
When the EKG came out, we immediately recognized there was a real serious problem. We got on to medical control. They called St. Joe's, and they were ready for us when we got there. We were at about eastbound 94 in Hamlin, and Charles suddenly went into cardiac arrest. The good thing with that is that he was hooked up and we saw that.
What were the EMTs saying to you?
We're not going to let you go. That's what was beautiful about it.
Probably a minute later, he did the same thing.
Most of the people that have heart attacks die on the way to the hospital because they rely on someone else to get them there.
For me, as a professional, 30 years worth of doing this, that we could go from having him cardiac arrest, him really being to the point where he's essentially not going to recover unless we do what we do for him, and then bring him into a cath lab that's going to do what they need to do for him to survive.
You know, they hung in there with me in that dinner. I guess that's what gave me the strength to go on. I had a total congestive heart failure. There was total blockage. The whole left side of my heart, it stopped pumping. It stopped functioning.
We had actually just finished a case, and immediately we heard that he was coming in. And what was different was that we were hearing that he had arrested in the field. And sometimes that's you worry about that being more of a dangerous circumstance, a more significant or serious heart attack. Quickly, I put an IV into his leg, and through that we pass long tubes, which are catheters, up to the heart, and we quickly inject and take some pictures of the arteries to find out where the problem was. These black lines are the arteries. Now, there should be a big black line coming down here that we don't see.
There's a lot of people that come in and they through the response team, and they make it, and they find out later on how bad they were.
Charles was pretty bad.
He was bad. If it had been any longer, he probably wouldn't have made it.
We'll quickly slide another catheter that has a balloon on the tip that's deflated. That slides right over the wire, right in the position where the plaque is. And then we inflate the balloon and just open it up. At that point, we restore the flow. And a lot of times people feel better, their pressure starts to improve, and some of these abnormal rhythms start to settle down, which in fact what happened in his case. He settled down pretty quickly at that point. And then at that stage, we start assessing the lesion, deciding how we're going to finish the treatment, which often involves putting a metal tube called a stent in there that stays in permanently.
There's the stents right there. And then it looks like this.
And that helps to open the artery, keep it from recollapsing, and keeping the vessel wide open so he ensures good flow down the vessel. You do have to work pretty quickly, and it's very challenging because you have to make a lot of decisions in a short period of time, and you've got to be right on those decisions. It's a little different from you see on TV. Sometimes you watch on ER and you see people screaming and yelling and get this, get that, and it's really not like that. In fact, that's not the way you want to do it. And you want an experienced staff around you. And you know, I'm really fortunate to have good people to work with who've seen the circumstance, they know what happens, and they just do their job and really work as a team. And it has to be that way for it to be ultimately successful.
Made a lot of good and beautiful people at St. Joseph's. Yeah. But I was running around the hospital like I owned it. You know, they were getting after me because I was unplugging myself and going about my business. They were on me all the time.
Charles is awesome. I told him that I felt he was getting healing so fast because of his attitude, his positive spirit, and his appreciation for being alive from what he went through, because that really scared him because he knew he could have died.
You've never met Dr. Culler, is that right?
No, never met him. Never met the man that saved my life.
Hey, how are you doing?
No.
Good to see you, buddy. How are you? How are
you? Good to see you.
How you doing?
I'm hanging in there.
You look good, huh?
The wall thanks to you.
Because we do good work.
A lot of times I don't get to follow up with some of these patients, so seeing Charles today really means a lot to me, and I think to our team. You just get a great feeling that you made such a big difference in someone's life, and it's for everybody. I mean, everybody's working together on this, and that's the biggest thing that you feel.
Kurt and Clint, you can have